Hello. Hello, everybody. Welcome all to this second day of the JUC, and thank you for attending this talk. Quick show of hands, who all have used the Jenkins Python API maybe before? Wow, quite a few. Cool. Okay. So another quick show of hands, how many of you were there for the MSys talk yesterday? Yeah. So all of you saw what happens when there is a demo and things like that, right? So I planned for the worst today. I thought nothing will work again. So I did all the command line stuff that I wanted to show all the programs, and I pasted them on the slides with the results, just in case nothing works. I mean, yesterday everything worked for a change, but just in case. Anyway, so yeah. So I introduced myself yesterday. I'll just do it for the sake of this talk. I live in India in a city called Pune. I work there in a company called MSys-Clogeny. Since 2005, I've been contributing to open source, namely the KDE desktop project. I have written a bunch of code for it. I have founded the KDE India community back in 2005. I have organized many conferences, the KDE-related conferences in India. Currently, I'm serving as the board of the KDEV board. My term is about to end next month. That's my introduction. And yeah, it's great to be here at JUC, and I'm still nervous. I was nervous yesterday. I'm still nervous. Anyway, so yeah, please forgive me for these bullets. So they were the right ones, the template that the CloudBees people sent us. But every time I close OpenOffice and reopen it, they become these blocks. I don't know why. And I have to close and restart, but otherwise it does not detect the two displays. And you won't be able to see the slides. Yeah, story of my life. Anyway, having said that, So why do we need this library? So what does this library do? So last few years, almost 2.5 years, I've been doing CI/CD. I've been writing lots of pipelines with two awesome friends of mine for our various clients. And our requirement was such that we had to do a lot of things in Python. And during the talk later, I'll tell you what kind of things I've been doing. We have done so. We couldn't rely on the nice little execute shell box or a execute window shell or a Python shell or Ruby shell. We had to write long scripts that would do the build stuff, that would also go and talk to some other jobs, find some things from that job maybe, find if it had passed yesterday or some particular build and things like that. And for that, we couldn't really rely on anything because of what the constraints we were having. We did not want to introduce another language or another technology in the middle of everything else that we had. So we looked for Python-based Jenkins API, and we found this library. And that's the whole idea of talking about this library. The agenda, as I said, will be this library. Why do we need it? How do we use it? At least the basics of it. Some of you seem to have used it. So maybe part of it or most of it will be familiar. I'll talk about various modules that this library comes with. I'll show you some code examples, by code examples, the things that I have copy-pasted. But yes, since things work, I can actually go to a command shell, and I have my Jenkins running, and we can do some experiments if you want. I'll talk about the documentation bit in the, or the rather the lack of, I can't say good documentation, but really lack of documentation in this library. And we'll do Q&A, hopefully, unlike yesterday, I finish within time. So the motivation, as I said, is going beyond the control that Jenkins and bunch of plugins that we get. Now, somebody might ask me now later that we do have Groovy API that you can use. Totally agreed. We do have it. As I said, our constraints was using Python. We were good in Python. We wanted to use Python. And it was a nice library. I could do anything with it. I could interface. I could write. I didn't have to write another script or another file or anything. I could do everything within my bunch of pipeline scripts that I had already written. So that's what I meant. Sometimes you need more fine-grained control. You have a bunch of plugins to do copy artifact, copy things to the slave and back, and things like that. But we really did not want to go into that because our jobs, as I said, we were using Jenkins just to trigger our scripts, and our scripts were doing all the hard work. All the heavy work was done by our Python scripts. We were probably calling Fabric and Chef in the interim, but that had nothing to do with this talk, but I'm just saying we had so many other things. So Python, Jenkins, I'm sure you all have seen that it has a nice REST API. You can actually make REST calls and trigger a job or stop a job and things like that. This library is on the top of that. It's a Python library. And the good thing is there are apparently two Python libraries which can talk to Jenkins. Having said that, I have used the one that I'm going to talk. And guess what? One is called Jenkins API, other is called Jenkins. So yeah, if you go and search, do a pip search or things like that, you will find it very similar things. I am using this one because on the initial, the cursory note that I did when I was searching for a particular library, I like this one. I basically, when I choose a library or choose a software for my own work, I go and see if it's being maintained properly. One of the things, if it's on GitHub or any public source code repository, one thing I check is when was the last time somebody pushed a code or merged a bug and things like that. This thing probably had 3 hours and the other thing had 3 weeks or something like that. It was an easy fix. And plus, looking at the code, I had to, as I said, the documentation is slightly flaky. Not the other one. I don't really know how well the other one is. I'm not trying to diss the other one. I basically have no opinion about the other one. I just like this one better because it had more modules and more whatnot. Yeah, I mean, if you are in open source for a long time, you have to start being a little bit diplomatic and start saying that you like this one better, you don't have anything else. I mean, I'm from the KDE versus GNOME world. Imagine what I've gone through. So the installation is like nothing, frankly. Choose your poison here. Do pip install, do easy install. Somehow on this particular laptop, pip install and easy install give me some kind of very, very weird errors. And I don't have, I'm too old to fight installation issues on a Linux machine. So I just do sudo apt-get in Python and it just works. As I said, there are other libraries, at least two I know of. I am using the one that works for me better. Now, we will talk about various modules. All of us are aware of, have used Python, right? So, a library, and then there are these classes and modules and whatnot. So I'll talk about the bunch of modules that there are briefly, and then I'll actually show each module, or many of those modules, and I'll show you, as I said, there will be code pasted, and they were mapped against the Jenkins machine node that I am running with multiple slaves. Huh. So these are the main modules that you have. Jenkins is the main object, the Jenkins object itself. It encapsulates the Jenkins instance that you have. You will see in the next slide, I believe, that you can basically give it a URL and it will start. You can then start talking to it. This API also supports authentication. So in my code base, I'm not using any authentication. It's on my machine, so I have not really set up any credentials or anything. But you could do authentication if you have a Jenkins, which you should, by the way, if you are maybe on a cloud network or any kind of Jenkins. We protect our Jenkins using password and whatnot. So we generally, for our pipeline scripts, our deployment scripts, if there is a need, we create a Jenkins user or a Jenkins API user or something on the system, and that is the one that does all the work, all the commits, or whatever, wherever this is required. So you need, there will be a Jenkins module, and I've written job, and I have put parentheses and jobs, because there are two classes, job and jobs. There are some bunch of helper method which will return you a generator object maybe, and you can fetch each job from there or each node from there or each builds from there and whatnot. So I'm not really returning all of them, but yeah, you have job class or a job module which will actually give you, encapsulate everything related to a job, the config, the name of the job, the description of the job, including the, as I said, configuration and things like that. Then there's this user API. Although it is there and it is probably in the documentation, it's highest, it's shown as the, like the thing. It's a bunch of convenience functions. While using the API, frankly, in all our scripts in this 1.5 year, I've never used it. Because I like the low-level control that I got with build and Jenkins and job and artifact and things like that. Those are good functions. Some of the good functions, I have shown them in the code. You could see that you have to do pretty much the same thing and probably write a little bit more when you're using the convenience function, although they are convenience functions. Then there is this builder. There's this build. Class which represents the build. You could access the numbers, the data from the build, and so on and so forth. We will see those in detail. Any complicated job probably has an artifact. It could be a package, it could be a WAR file, it could be a text file. I mean, we had a very simple text file as one of our artifact. The simple text file was basically the ID of the AMI, AWS AMI, right? It was looked simple, but we had to use that ID itself from one job, and we had to use it in some other job. So manipulating artifacts is something very important. When I come to a certain stage, I'll tell you what kind of war stories we have faced. Not really something difficult, but what was our use case. Then there is Node. There are a bunch of other classes, frankly, and modules, plugin and whatnot. I've not really listed each one of them, but this particular library, because of the documentation, you have to, if you use it, in fact, with the other library as well, and many other open source libraries, perhaps, in various other languages and products, you have to read the source code. That's the best way to do it, or you have to poke around. So when I was learning this, when I was first using this library, what I did was every time I faced, I had to use a method, and I had to find how this works. Either I was reading the source code, or after the first method, whatever I got as a return value, I was doing a type on it or a dir on it and finding all the methods on it and then trigger. So I had to learn by trial and error, and I still have to do it. But the stuff that you get eventually, you can write really complicated stuff. I was just talking to someone called as Smith, I think, during lunch. I really don't remember his name now, but he has been working on this for. He said that he has used this quite a lot, and he works. They have like a bunch of Python stuff, and he does lots and lots of orchestration using the Python API. So yeah, it's really powerful. Again, I'm really sorry for the bullet marks. I spent half an hour fixing those, and now I had to restart this slide, and it again comes back. So yeah, think this as a Python console. So to get an instance, it's as simple as I said, I am just writing a method because I'll be using this method later on in my next slide or somewhere else. So all you need to do is import the Jenkins object and create an object out of it. If you want auth, then you actually pass the username and the password as the next two parameters. Ideally, you will not pass them in the code. You will put them in a config file and read the config file and not commit the config file, hopefully, or from the environment variable or something like that. Do a os.get environment or something like that. That would be the ideal case. As I said, my system doesn't have a credential set for this particular Jenkins. So once you get this, you get a Jenkins object. Now you can start manipulating it, or rather using it as you want. Yeah. So once you have, so many of these classes and methods will have this method is mapped to kind of a dict, wherein if you do the keys thing, it's very, very unintuitive in my opinion. That's because, if I had not written the word job, Jenkins.keys would be beefy and simple. I mean, that's as intuitive as pink and red, in my opinion, because keys method doesn't really tell you anything. The interestingly, what Jenkins object has this keys method, which actually returns all the names of all the jobs on your, in your machine. So you can do only so much with it, but I'm just telling you, it's a good thing because maybe you want to list all the jobs and this is the quickest way to do it, and maybe you want to find if the particular job is there. You could write, think about it, you are moving from one, and I have had this experience. We were moving from one product to other product, we were pivoting for a particular client, and we had to delete literally hundreds of jobs. No way I was going to delete them up manually, tick, 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 no way. Okay, so the best thing is to do this and start deleting. But obviously, I didn't know it is using Python. I did using Groovy too. For at that time, I did not know about this API. And Jenkins has this nice Groovy console. I think you don't need to install any plugin, or maybe you need to, and you can start writing code in that, and you can do manipulate Jenkins objects. Anyway, once you do the keys, you get all the. But that's not really good because it's just text, and you don't get the job object, which is what you want. I mean, to do anything useful with it. So there is a helper method within the Jenkins object itself, rather a method for Jenkins object. If you do get jobs, you get a generator. And you get from there, you can actually iterate, and you can actually get all the jobs. So you get a tuple of the name of the job and the job object. And from here on, you can use it as you want. And you will see in the next slide. So once you have a job, what you can do is, I mean, maybe you want to, you already know the, I mean, in my use case, the one that I'm showing, I already know the name of the job, but you could have actually from the list, from using the keys, or maybe the second top, the list of tuples that you saw, you could actually do a string match or a regex match and find the exact name of the job that you want and pass it on to get job. Here you get the exact job object. You could have used the second parameter, the second in the, item in the tuple as well, and actually done the same thing. Once you have that, you have a bunch of methods which will tell you the description of the job. If it is set, from my experience, unless it's really required, in many cases, most people don't put jobs. We, as a policy, generally put descriptions so that we know what the particular job is. Once you have like hundreds of jobs, you really need some kind of good description, sorry. Then you can check if a job is enabled, disabled. In fact, you can, if I'm not mistaken, later in the slide, you can actually disable a job. Let's just check in a bit. You can find if a job is running. So all these runs are, I did not type them randomly. This were experiments that I have done on my machine, and we can actually do those here as well. So don't think that I put in true because I just wanted to show you true. I mean, trust me, it works. And then you can get this here, the things get interesting. For a particular job, you want the last table build number. Why do you want that? Think about a use case when you want to find the last table build or the last successful build for a particular job. And using something from that job, you want to do something here in the job B. That's where the number is used. In fact, you can even get the build data and things like that. So there are a bunch of, I think in one slide down or two slides down, I have listed some of the methods, all the methods, because I really cannot show you all the methods. But yeah, those are there. So you can do last failed build number as well. You can find completed build. It's there. This thing. You can invoke a job. So think about it. In your pipeline scripts or in your scripts, what you can do is do some checks, find if a job exists, and then invoke it. I mean, depending on your certain conditions. So for example, in one of the project that I'm working on right now, we do certain checks. We see, we put something in a Redis queue and things like that. And it's integrated with, for some reasons, it's integrated with Mercurial. And what happens here is, in a certain things happen, we go and check if for a particular project, if jobs are set, tests are set, and whatnot. And only if those things are true, we actually invoke them. So it's basically your, playing field, that whatever you want to do. Anyway, after I do invoke it, you will, if I had shown this live, you would have seen it will be wait for a bit. The build would start and it would return immediately. It's not a blocking function, and it returns. The thing that I wanted to tell you out there was completed build. Sometimes, actually many a times, there are you have to abort a build. You go and click and the things get aborted. The build gets aborted. This API has quite a few helper functions, get last successful build, get last stable build, get last completed build. The stable build and successful build will give you a green build, but completed build will give you a build even if it was aborted. Just remember that, because you'd never know. I mean, they look so similar, but yeah, they are not, the values that are returned by them. For a particular job, if you have set a SCM type, maybe you're using Git or you're using Subversion or anything else, Mercurial maybe, I don't know. It will return the type, you can get the branches, you can get the URL. Think right now, I'm sure you are getting ideas already that you could actually check if the branch is correct in your pipeline script, if you can actually check if the branch has been set correctly for the particular job. Maybe it's not master you need to access. Maybe some other Git branch, maybe a release branch. This particular pipeline is for release branch, so maybe it should be release. So your job configuration is wrong. So you could technically check the job configuration here, at least parts of it. So yeah, I mean, as I said, these are very, very small building blocks, but the amount of, you build a palace using small building blocks. That's what the whole thing is. As I said, you can disable a job, you can enable a job, and things like that. These are very simple things. But my interest are this because we have used this for a bit. You see this URL because it's configured to the job that I was using yesterday. So yeah. So there are a bunch of methods. If you do this is not a complete list. I just selected some of the important ones. So there are a bunch of stuff that you can see the last build build. Notice how there is a function for build and a build number. Build number is just a number. Build is the build object. Then you can, we were talking about jobs. I think the next module we will cover is build. So we can actually use those build objects and manipulate from there as well. So you get a bunch of stuff. You can get the parameters of the job. You can get the revision. We already saw that. You can check if a job is queued. If it's queued, don't run maybe the next job. Maybe there is something, some automation that push triggers of the job. So in your pipeline, you can check if a particular job is queued. Maybe not this job, some other job. This should not run when this job is running, so you can actually go and check if that job is queued or running or things like that. So quite a few things that you can do. The user API, I'll not really discuss it in depth. There are maybe 10, 15 methods in that. What I don't like about this method, most of this helper methods, is every time I have to use this, I have to give the URL for the Jenkins instance. I might as well just give it once when I'm creating the Jenkins object and start using it every time I want, right? It gives you the same result if you actually remember somewhere here, I got the same last completed bit 53. I got the same thing, last complete build, using the same method because I didn't run anything in between. But having said that, there are some methods which are very important. You can actually search through your complete history and find any particular type of artifact you want that goes by a certain name or something like that. So it's not like it's useless. There are a bunch of methods that are very useful. It is just that it's an annoyance to type so much. That's my opinion, at least. Now the build stuff. You just pass on a number. This is one of the helper methods for a job. If you pass on the build number, you can check if a build is running. As I said, you must be getting ideas right now what you can do with this. You can check a particular revision. That's a Git revision. If obviously that particular job is configured to use Git and it's checking out. It's as same as, I'm sure most of you have seen environment variables that some of the plugins set, and the Git plugin sets few things like the Git commit and things like that, right? And the revision and things like that. So basically, you can actually access some of those here. You can get the name, and you can get the status. One thing I noticed, and I have not really found, figured it out even after reading the source code, there is no way to find out if the job build is running, at least in the source code, in the constants where success is defined. There is no such thing as running. There is failed, there is aborted, and I can show you the source code in a bit. But there's no such thing as running, so I need to figure that out, how that can be done. You can block a job, build, things like that using certain methods, but to find out if a build is running, there was something skewed and running for a job, but there's no particular status as such. So the method that we saw sometime back in this list, you can use those to find if a job is running and things like that. Yeah, I wonder who will use this method. I have never used it in 2 years, but you can actually get the whole console log. And this was a test job, and it has so much of data, because, and we used to have literally kilobytes of console logs, because we were building RPMs, multiple RPMs, and then RPMs were getting installed. We were building AMIs, and there was Packer in it. Packer would be this verbose amount of debug lines and things like that. So maybe you will find a use case for this. Maybe you will put in a secret token somewhere in your console log, and you can grep if everything went well or something like that. But it's available. I mean, you should know that. I mean, I found it a little bit funny, to be honest. But yeah, it's interesting that you can actually get this as well. I mean, for me, even reading Jenkins console is so much of a work, because it's really huge. And you have to do the full log thing and then read it very carefully, just in case you don't miss it. I don't know how I will read this. Build also has a bunch of stuff. You could check the results URL. You could get the revision, as I said. You could check if it is a good build, has a result, and things like that. And you can get the artifacts and things like that. We will see artifacts next. So a bunch of things that you can do with this as well. So I was telling you about the use cases that we were doing. So what was happening in our case was we had multiple pipelines, one building certain thing, the other thing doing some other things. And the final thing was our final output was always an AMI. This AMI, to be built, it needed RPMs from multiple different jobs. And those RPMs needed to be the right ones. So we were storing the RPM. We were storing the RPMs in our RPM repository, but we needed to tag along, do a tag team basically with some other jobs, and we needed to find which was the last success. So we went and checked in our AMI scripts, or the scripts that were building AMI. We were checking for some other job which was building RPMs and things like that, or whichever the parent. I can't say parent job, but jobs before that. So those were not really parent jobs, if I remember correctly, but the jobs that run before, that's about it. So yeah, multi-phase job, so a job that ran before. So we were checking what happened. We were finding the last successful build. If we find the last successful build, we went and checked the artifacts. If an artifact existed, we went and read that file. Once we read that file, we either got an RPM ID, or maybe we got an AMI ID. So even after this AMI pipeline, we also had a production or a gold master pipeline, which would take the first, the AMI that would be built for every check-in. We would take one of them and actually make it a gold master AMI or something like that. So we would run some production scripts on it. So even in that case, we would go and read the artifact from some other, the AMI pipeline, and run it in the final AMI pipeline. So as I said, it's a literally a huge canvas that you can get once you start using this API. Then the artifacts. So once you have, so for this, what I did was I just created a mock artifact by creating in the build step, just creating a simple text file. And once I did was I tried to get the, so there are a bunch of methods that I can use to get the artifacts. So I just use the artifact dict. Here I get name and a dict of name and the path of the object. I can query using this way, the way I have done it, and I can get the data. This could have been, so this is what basically I did. I read the AMI file out here. It's as simple as that. It could have been something else. We could have actually got a the file object here. We can actually copy over the file. There are save method and save to folder methods in this artifact class. We can actually save it to a right place. And maybe it's an WAR file, you want to deploy it, you could do that. Or if it's an RPM or a Debian package or anything like that, you could put it in the correct repository and things like that. Yeah. Next is nodes. I pretty much had very less, if at all, to work with this API. But frankly, all it does is you can check if a particular node is online, and you can put it in your script and do something with it. But I had never had the use case to use it. While trying, though, I figured that some of the methods, I had problems using them. For example, when I was trying to disable or take a slave offline. So this, I'm not sure if I did something wrong or the API is not working properly. But I tried a few things, they didn't work. So I couldn't take nodes offline using the programmatically this way. But yeah, as I said, because I've not really worked with this node, I really don't have an opinion on the nodes object. I can do a bunch of things with plugins, but this is another thing that we had hardly ever the need to use them. That's because we were not really creating Jenkins instances dynamically. Our job was to build AMIs or build pipelines or build huge storage-related stuff and things like that. So once the plugin was installed, we pinned them to a certain version. We don't really change them often. So this is something with the API I've hardly touched. Other than the nodes, you actually can access even the executors and whatnot. Again, since I've never touched the nodes, I never touched the executors as well. Yeah, exceptions. So there is always someone in your group, in your company, in your project, who is the gatekeeper or the watchman of your code, and they will be very, very pragmatic about writing good Python code or writing whichever language code. So they will, and for a good thing, by the way, I totally respect whoever forces me to pile int my code and whatnot because the code looks good. So one of the Pythonic ways is to use exceptions. That's what I have learned in my years of Python. Luckily, this library, instead of doing if this and if that, we actually throw exceptions. This list is not exhaustive. Only few important ones. But if you have a problem, these exceptions will be thrown. So in your pipeline scripts, you can actually catch them and take actions if need be, or whatever you deem fit. But these exceptions, there are a few more exceptions, even related to SCM and whatnot. You should look at the source code. Again, this is not documented. So you have to actually go into the code to find those out. Even in the examples, these are not. In my opinion, the examples that come in the code, some of them have not really worked for me. So I'm not sure if they're a good idea to be used. So look at the code always. As I say, use the source look. The other things that you can do, you can actually create jobs. There are helper methods within that within Jenkins object to create a job. You feed it an XML, the job config XML, and you get a nice little job in your Jenkins instance. And you can configure it later. You can give it a file and whatnot. Similarly, you can create views, nested views, and things like that. I've never tried the views, frankly, but I've tried jobs. It works well. You can, as we saw, you can query and monitor builds, jobs, nodes. You can search and manipulate artifacts. Documentation. I can show you the documentation. Basically, three classes are documented: the user API, the build, and artifacts. That's it. Three classes are documented, at least last I checked, which was today morning, unless I went to a wrong URL. But it's not, because I've seen the source code. But this is the URL. I will share the slide, so you really don't need to take them down. But yeah, if you Google for Jenkins API, you'll end up, Python Jenkins API, you'll end up with two of them. One that says 0.48 is this one. And the best, I cannot really remember the names. I remember the name of the author, Salim Fadle. That's how I remember, and there are a bunch of other contributors. Great library, frankly. I mean, we have used it to the hilt. We have checked, we have invoked jobs, we have not really blocked. We never had the use case of trying with blocking jobs or blocking a build or things like that, but we have definitely explored the hell out of working with the artifacts and finding the right builds from the last successful build or last failed. We find which is the right build and whatnot. Yeah, I can show you demo if you want to for some of the things, or we can go into question answer session. So, to repeat his question, he asked that, what did I learn and what are the best approaches using this API versus plugin-based approaches, right? Okay, so let me be very clear. I am not saying that I don't use plugins at all. I do use plugins and loads of them. It is our pipeline scripts demanded that we control certain aspects of our jobs and multiple jobs that we have using in a programmatic way, and instead of relying on standard plugins or things like that. I mean, you can copy artifacts and whatnot, right, to a right place and things like that. But that's the reason we chose it. It was not something better or worse. It was the tool of the tool for the problem that we needed to solve. We had everything in Python. If we had to do something else somewhere else, we would be basically creating headache and technical debt for us when somebody else moves and things like that. So it was best to put everything in Python. That's about it. The best practices way, what we did was, I'm not sure if this is best practices, but we basically created some modules in our source for any utilities that we realize that we have more than a little bit of helper methods. We, in my code base, it's always a library or a utils folder where I will have Git utils, subprocess utils, or Jenkins utils, or Redis utils, or things like that. I would put a bunch of functions there and use it across my method, those methods. I just use them. That's the only thing. So every code base that you will see in my projects, you will find Jenkins utils or things like that. So I just put them in one place and start using them across my other scripts. That's the thing that I do. But this is a standard practice for any program thing as opposed to a Jenkins API thing. I'd like to thank, I really want to thank the JUC people. They have really gone beyond their call of duty yesterday to literally, so I cannot thank them enough. And many other people, including my family and my company folks, and these two people out there with whom I have written, I don't know how many thousand lines of Jenkins scripts, Girija and Rupali. They have been my partners in crime for a long time. Girija still is. Rupali has moved on to a different company. Me and Girija moved to a different company, so I really have to thank them. Yeah, please share your comments on the app. I really like looking for feedback yesterday because I went overboard. I am getting feedbacks. I got some good feedbacks today. So yesterday night, I was very worried. I was not sleeping. I couldn't sleep even. But yeah, I got some good feedback. So I'm going to sleep tonight well. Other than that, yesterday I shared a coupon code. That's still valid. If you can meet me outside, and I'll give you the coupon code. That's for the a book in progress for MSys in action. Please, I'm not the author, but I am reviewing it. It's a great book. A few chapters are written, so if you want to buy it, you can buy it. It's a 50% off that you will get. Thank you so much for all coming. I really appreciate you coming here. Thank you so much.